Good afternoon. I'm Fox Weddle, the Dean of the School of Public Health at Brown University. And first, I would like to acknowledge that today is Veterans Day and that perhaps we should take a moment to give thanks to all of those veterans who have given so much to serve and protect us and our country. And I'd just like to say thank you. And I'd also like to thank each of you for joining us this afternoon. From the Brown School of Public Health and the Rhode Island School of Design Graduate School for this symposium, which is focused on how design can improve population health. The symposium grows out of a broader set of collaborative activities and initiative, which is supported by Brown and by RISD, to encourage activities that bring together research and educational programs. And we were very pleased to receive support from this initiative from our two presidents for this particular project. We who are working on the Place Matters project view this as a first step in developing a research and educational agenda focused on improving health through better design of neighborhoods and urban areas. Through this joint collaboration between Brown and RISD, we are committed to advancing research on innovative strategies to reduce urban health disparities through urban planning and design, through community engagement, through targeted interventions, and through policy enhancements. This is a first event of an ongoing series of conversations about how we can design neighborhoods in order to reduce health risk and build resilience in urban communities. The goal for this symposium is to provide an interdisciplinary forum for public health researchers and practitioners, artists, designers, and policymakers to improve health in urban communities. We will begin the symposium with Richard Jackson's keynote address, followed by a panel discussion with several local experts in the fields of design and population health. I would like to take a moment to specially thank the Planning Committee for their very hard work in bringing this project together. These include Patty Phillips, RISD's Dean of Graduate Studies. Patty, wave your hand. There's Patty. Nadine Gerdts, who's Senior Critic in the Department of Landscape Architecture. There she is. Akilah Dulin-Keita, who is an Assistant Professor of Behavioral and Social Sciences in our Brown School of Public Health. Karen Scanlon, who is the Director of Communications for the School of Public Health. There's Karen. Right. And myself, who worked on this project. So now it is, thank you. Now it is my pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, public health crusader and national leader in the area of reducing risk and building resilience in urban communities, Dr. Richard J. Jackson. Dr. Jackson is professor and chair of environmental health sciences in the School of Public Health at the University of California in Los Angeles. As a pediatrician, he's served in many leadership positions in both environmental health and infectious disease with the California Health Department, including the highest state position, the state health officer. For 9 years, he was director of the CDC National Center for Environmental Health in Atlanta and received the Presidential Distinguished Service Award. In October 2011, he was elected to the Institute of Medicine of the National Academy of Sciences, and I highly recommend his book, Designing Healthy Communities. It's wonderful, and you'll have to wrestle it from my grasp to get it away from me. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Richard Jackson.
He is the author of co-author of a couple of the books that are up there. He said, "Oh, you're going to the finest undergraduate school in the country." Is a graduate. And when I said to my sister, who is an artist who went to the New York School of Visual Arts, that I was coming to RISD, she said, "That's the finest art school in the country." So I've actually been more nervous about this whole presentation than I normally would be. I was trying to show you the video for the series. It's shown now in about 2 million homes in the United States and encapsulates sort of the emotional side of this issue of environment and health, and also the technical and medical sides of this as well. The book on the right, on the left, your left, is the textbook I use at UCLA. And I do a joint class. We have about 30 students in the class. Half come from public health, the other half come from something else, whether it's mostly planning, but architecture, business, law, other areas. I started the joint program at Berkeley, by the way, between public health and architecture and planning as well. And I make them do a joint presentation. My favorite was one time the young woman was a public health person specializing in violence prevention, and the young man was designing a transit-oriented development. And he suddenly realized, oh, no woman would want to walk along here because the sight lines are terrible. She'd feel isolated and endangered. And the young woman realized, oh my God, actually everything around me was in somebody's head. It was designed by somebody. And it's a product of someone's imagination. And so they actually did a joint project. It was absolutely terrific and eventually got married. So I'm really done a very good job. It is Veterans Day, and this I've got a number of favorite veterans. One is my brother Jim, who served in Vietnam. Describe it as apocalypse now. This is my dad. He got his wings in 1943 at Brooks Air Force Base in San Antonio. On December 8th, 1941, he volunteered, left his sweetheart, and went off to the Army Air Force. He trained, he crashed once in the training. He had about 2,000 hours in the Air Force and was, of course, eventually sent into combat. This is flying over Iwo Jima. He survived an attack on his barracks where about half the pilots were killed while he was at Iwo Jima. He flew escort missions over to Japan. He had seen an awful lot of ugly stuff during that time. His flight log shows him in the air in August 6, 1945. I don't know if what he witnessed that day. But he came back. He married his beautiful Irish girlfriend. And I was born during the war, and the next two children were born very quickly afterwards. But on August of 1949, Bob began to have a little trouble breathing and said to my mother, and he's hitting himself against the wall in order to take a breath. This is a guy that could do 100 push-ups at age 27 without even stopping. He was running the airport in Portland, Maine, and eventually took him to the hospital. And 2 days later, he died of polio, and leaving my mother with three babies. And my New Jersey family came up, collected us, and took us back to New Jersey. And I ended up really growing up in poverty. And my mother, this was probably, of course, the hardest thing in my mother's life. She died about 2 years ago, and she did remarry, wonderful stepdad and four more half-siblings, but she wanted to be buried with Bob 60 years later. Infectious diseases were the reality of the world you grew up in. Bob was born in Hudson, Massachusetts, and his father died in his 50s because he had had diphtheria as a child and was left with heart disease and eventually died of of sequelae. When I was young, my sweetheart in middle school, beautiful girl, developed measles. Ended up getting meningitis, meningoencephalitis, and was ended up basically brain damaged from that experience. And illness was the reality of life. Illness was the norm. Now we think it's abnormal to be sick, but someone had a toothache every month. Someone had, when you got mumps as a male, an adolescent male, it was like having two hot coals between your legs because your testicles would be so inflamed. And we take it for granted now because we have improved health so much. We've added 30 years to the average lifespan of Americans since my grandfather was born. 30 years. And if I go across the street at UCLA and I say to the doctors at UCLA, we live 30 years longer, why do you think that is? I'm sure most of them, the surgeons at least, would say, well, that's because we're really good doctors. We do heart transplants. And the truth is, and I'm saying this to the RISD folks because public health don't, 25 of those years have come from two big I's. Immunization, all those diseases that just terrorize people 50 years, 100 years ago, greatly diminished. And I had the honor of working on both smallpox and polio eradication. And infrastructure, how we build the worlds that we were in. And the infrastructure, the world that we were living in 1885, 1900, was pretty miserable. Cities were pretty miserable. And I'll come back to that in a second. This is my first encounter with public health, was being released from quarantine. I can imagine what that was like. Well, I was really grappling with, what do I do with my life? There were no books in the house, except the ones we got from the Carnegie Libraries, thanks to the philanthropy that started those libraries, those beautiful buildings, because we couldn't afford them. And the most interesting and educated people that were around me were the Jesuit priests. And so I decided at 16, 17, well, I thought I wanted to be a Jesuit because I really wanted to do something with my life, and went off into the seminary, and I was actually in the Society of Jesus Seminary was in Poughkeepsie, New York. It was sold eventually to the Culinary Institute of America. And if you ever visit there, that's where I spent the 2 years speaking entirely in Latin. And I got very naughty. I was a little lonely. And I, after a while, discovered I was sneaking out the door and walking over to Vassar because I wanted to talk to girls. There was a message here, Dick. And then I found a book that was written in English, so I was tired of reading Latin, so I read it, and it was Walden by Thoreau. And at that point, I was tired of Plato and Aristotle and Socrates and Thomas Aquinas, and this was the first philosopher that I ever read that really made sense to me as an American. And I've read Thoreau every year since that time, and it gives me a sense of being connected to the world much more than the distant stuff. Well, I got out of the seminary in the peak of the Vietnam War. Two of my brothers were in Vietnam in sequence. And so I said, you know, I think I'll go to medical school because I really wanted to serve with my life, and ended up getting into San Francisco and went to UCSF and became a pediatrician. And I'm working in the nursery at UCSF, and very sick baby, about 32-weeker, appears. And she has gastroschisis, failure of the closure of the abdomen. We had two more that week, all from the same area near Fresno, California, big agricultural area, lots of chemical use going on. And one of the nurses says to the attending, you think there's some chemicals they're using out there that are causing this? And he goes, well, it's probably just a Poisson distribution, probably just random assortment that's causing it. It's stuck in my head. And I'm not making this up. About a month later, we had 3 neural tube defects, failure of closure of the spine, from, the same geographic area. And I thought, you know, I'm going to pursue this. So I owed time to the Public Health Service. I went to CDC and did infectious disease epidemiology in New York, but really wanted to go back and think more about what happened to poor people, what happened to disenfranchised people who were exposed to chemicals, didn't know what they were. They knew they smelled bad. They knew they were yellow or brown. The growers wouldn't tell them what they were using. They were picked up at a labor center somewhere and taken out to the fields and do the harvesting. So I began to pursue environmental epidemiology. And I did that, to make a long story short, for about a dozen years. And in 1994, we were living in Berkeley. I'd married a Californian. I've actually suffered from bicoastality ever since. It's a desperate disease. And I said, oh, we're going to move to Atlanta. I'm going to become the director of the National Center for Environmental Health. This is like, for a public health person, being put on the Supreme Court. And Dad, we don't want to go. Oh, you can have your own bedroom, because if you live in Berkeley, all 3 boys were in one bedroom because you can't afford a bigger house. And we'll even get a dog. So I finally talked my wife and the boys into moving. We get there, it's 94 degrees, 94% humidity, and they're sure I am the stupidest man in the world. But it turned out to be a spectacular job with really a whole range of issues that I was confronting all the time. I forgot I had this slide in here. The other thing I realized in medical school was as I was holding that little baby that I was going to send home. We had taken care of that child, and he now had a number of brain bleeds, had hydrocephalus. We're sending twins home to that we were spending about $10,000 a day to take care of, to an 18-year-old mother to now take care of. And we did this over and over. We're spending huge amounts of money on disease care and next to nothing on prevention as a society. So I ran an event at my school on the skyrocketing cost of healthcare. And I said, 7% of all the money in the United States going to medical care, that's outrageous. And you know what it is now. And we're in the process of probably destroying the American economy if we keep dumping so much money into medical care. And therefore, because we spend twice as much money per capita as anybody else in the world, we're therefore the healthiest people in the world, right? Number 49. My son, who's now an internist and works at CDC, was overseas, this is a long time ago, probably when he was in college, and he's working in Costa Rica, and he sends a note and says, Dad, the people in Costa Rica live exactly as long as the Americans do, and they spend seven times as much less money as Americans do. They spend a lot on immunization, they spend a lot on prevention, and very little on end-stage medical care. So one of the things that, if you ask the average American, how's your life going? They say it's really going quite badly. And by all the measures, the behavioral risk factor survey and everything else, people describe their health deteriorating. They describe feeling less and less happy. And even when you correlate the fact that nobody's earning more money, we're not doing that well in terms of happiness and all the things that Americans think we're about. Four-time increase in the consumption of antidepressants. If you're clinically depressed and you need them, fine. But what's going on when the people in the prime of life are taking four times as many antidepressants as a long time ago? I've already talked about the fact that 5 years have come from medical care, the other 35 from public health. So after I was at CDC, you'll be shocked to hear this, I had a run-in with the Bush administration. And it was time for me to move back to California, and I became the health officer for Governor Schwarzenegger, Michael Fine's job for California. It was a hard job. I had about 230 bills in the legislature at any one time, and I never knew what I was going to be called. My first day in the job, I was called over and asked what my position was on condoms in the adult film industry. I had never thought about this in my life. The third week I was there, I'm sitting in, and this is a big operation. It's like $100 billion going through the health department in California. And there's like 20 people in the room. And it turned out I was the only physician of the group. And at one point they're talking about tuberculosis in the prisons. And we're dealing with a lot of TB in the prisons. And finally I said, well, blah, 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 blah. And I said something. And they said, how do you know that? I said, well, I'm a doc. I was at CDC. I've been doing public health for 25 years. He said, they teach you that at the California Department of Corrections? CDC. So, but there's a metaphor here because the California and much of our, we spend more money on people in prison than we do on the University of California, for example. And again, this issue of priority and where we really are going to get the bang for the buck. So one day I'm asked to be on an AM radio talk show. Be very careful about what you say yes to. And I show up and there's this red-faced, deeply overweight, OxyContin, tobacco-smelling AM radio host who says, oh, you're from the government. You must be corrupt, stupid, or lazy. That was the opening of the AM radio show. So while I'm not corrupt, if you see where I live, you'd believe it, I'm not lazy because I work really hard, but I do feel ignorant a lot of the time. I'm always, and that's the nature of medicine, you're always at the end of your knowledge all the time. But I said, sir, the purpose of public health is not to create the nanny state. The purpose of public health is to give people the conditions where they can be healthy. And that's what we do when we get rid of tobacco from a campus or get rid of tobacco from restaurants and other settings. When we get rid of soft drinks from the stores or at least tax them in some ways to make them more expensive. We're creating conditions that make it easier for people to be healthy. This is CDC headquarters. So that job was really hard. We had oversight of the destruction of the chemical weapons of the United States at 7 different sites around the United States, $1 billion for one of these facilities to destroy the chemical weapons. By the way, they're just powerful pesticides, to be honest. I'm not making that up. Anniston, Alabama was one of the sites that we went to. We had the childhood lead program for $50 million a year, and lead is, and your wonderful former health officer, Peter Simon, knows a huge amount about lead poisoning and the big lawsuit that's gone on. CDC just cut its $50 million lead program because the current director thinks we ought to be worried about winnable battles, and yet I would argue that housing is the ultimate issue for children's health. We had oversight of the ships that docked in San Francisco, in the United States for cruise ships because a bunch of congressmen got sick, I think, is the real reason, but on and on and on. So the director of CDC calls one day, and he says, I want you, all the directors, to come and help me think about the big threats of the 20th century. And I'm going thinking about atoms of lead and molecules of endocrine disrupting chemicals that distort fish and bird and human development to feminize them. I'm thinking about big issues of injury. I'm thinking about huge issues of climate change. And these are the climate change issues. Here's Rhode Island, and you were zone 6. This is not a political statement. This is from the landscape architects who say when you plant certain trees, USDA, and zone 6 is back in 1990 for you, and here you are now moving to about zone 7. And you all know that you're going to lose your sugar maples in New England within a certain amount of time, just how rapidly things have changed over time. And I think climate change is probably the issue, and maybe in the Q&A we can talk about this, and how artists and people that are leaders of our culture can get us as a society to think about the things that are deeply important, such as climate change. I'm going to skip these, and I apologize. Anyway, I'm heading over to CDC headquarters, and I'm driving down Buford Highway in Atlanta, Georgia. 7 lanes wide, mile between the various crosswalks, homes of the poor all the way along, and highest pedestrian death rate in the state of Georgia. And I look over to the side of the road, and it's 94 degrees, 94% humidity as usual, and there's an elderly woman walking along, and she's bent over with osteoporosis, and she has a shopping bag, one in each hand, and it's really hot, I wanna pick her up, and I don't do it. I go to the meeting, and we're talking big issues, distant issues. All I can think of is this poor woman, if she collapses and dies, the cause of death will be heat stroke. But it won't be absence of trees, heat island effects, degraded air quality, too much traffic, absence of public transportation. And if she's killed by a truck going by, the cause of death will be motor vehicle trauma, and it won't be absence of sidewalks, failed political leadership. And so I went back and I called Howie Frumkin, a Brown graduate, and I said, Howie, I think we've focused on things that are really very far from people's lives. What people really care about is where they live, where their kids live. Well, the American policy after World War II, in order to put 19 million GIs to work, and also because Eisenhower had observed the importance of the Autobahn in Germany, we began to build highways, largest public works project in the world. We built 3 million garages that happened to have houses attached to them. And we basically now have more cars in the United States than we have licensed drivers. I put this in, everybody knows that the last crop for farmers is houses, but this makes it very hard when you've paved over the best farmland in the country. And we public health people want people to grow local food, use as little chemical as you possibly can, have it fresh and healthy, save money, give people meaningful work, but once the prime land has really been turned to houses, it's very hard to do that. This is a picture of the California state flower, and they work really well until everybody discovers that this is really a very good way to get from one place to another. So every meeting where I am starts with the following statement. I'm sorry I'm late, there was a wreck on such and such, because I won't tell that story, but driving is not especially good for you. It raises your blood pressure, your cholesterol, your blood sugar, your adrenaline levels, and raises your risk of having a heart attack for at least the hour afterward you do that, your cortisol levels as well. And if you drive, in general, you weigh about 6 pounds more than somebody who does a lot of walking. That's the difference between, for example, a Manhattanite and somebody who's living in suburbia. We've all gained more than 6 pounds, but driving all the way is doing. So I wrote a paper. I kept obsessing about this. I said, boy, the way we've built America is bad for people. And so I wrote a paper with Chris Kotiski, and I said, we have built America that's bad for people's health. We've legislated, planned it, funded it, supported it, taxed it, and all the rest. And I published it, and the home builders of America thought I was the biggest communist that ever lived. And they got a dozen members of Congress, I think one of them is now going to be head of the Senate Environment Committee, to write a letter telling CDC they should fire Jackson because that fool doesn't know what he's talking about and he's hostile to the American way. Well, the boss calls me and he goes, Dick, where's your data? I said, well, it's just obvious. If you build places where people can't walk, they don't walk. If you make people totally car dependent, they're broke. If you pollute the air with cars, it's bad for people's lungs. He goes, Dick, you don't have any direct data. He didn't fire me, but he said, you got to go get this data. All right. So here's obesity. And I'm doing this for the RISD folks. The public health folks have seen this a lot. But these are the maps of obesity in the United States in 1991, 1997, and 2010. Average Americans gained about 27 pounds. And Dr. Fine will help us talk about issues in Rhode Island. So 6 of those pounds are really from how we build things. Being overweight's bad for us, but it's not as bad as a couple other things we're going to talk about. Oh, causes of overweight. We eat stuff that's not good for us. We human beings like salt, sugar, and fat. So they make this really cheap, and we have spent $14 billion a year as Americans on price supports for corn, soy, and commodities that are bad for us, and the things that are good for us, like fruits and vegetables, have become... Since 1980, they're twice as expensive as they were in real dollars in 1980. And the stuff that's bad for us is half as expensive. So when people say, oh, those poor people, they're stupid, they eat junk food. Well, it's a smart short-term economic decision to eat junk food. And really, in some ways, maybe that's a big takeaway here, is how do we begin to have a long view on our decisions? By the way, this is me when I was the Secret Service man guarding the governor. And it was really about California would like to see price supports for that. So we just passed last Tuesday a tax initiative to tax sugar in Berkeley, my hometown. And I'm very pleased about it. Human beings are not designed to eat 63 pounds of, half of it would be fructose, high fructose corn sugar. That's how much we consume a year. It's bad for our liver. It looks to our liver like alcohol. Well, as our body weight went up, our risk of diabetes went up. It goes up more for women than it goes up for men. But this is one of the big outcomes of this. So what do you think the diabetes maps would look like? RISD folks, you can predict what it's going to be like. So here's 1994, 2001, 2007. You walk down the street in Florida now, and one person in nine has a disease that's going to cost him his eyes, his kidneys, and his feet. We talk about this in the video a fair amount. 2% of the entire GDP of the United States right now is going to this one disease. And everybody my age in this room has lost friends and loved ones to this disease. It's very difficult to manage. When I was a young pediatrician, I'm just going to back one. When I was a young pediatrician, I went to the pediatric diabetes clinic. And you know how many kids I saw with diabetes type 2, adult onset diabetes in the clinic? None. Now you go to the clinic and half the kids have adult onset diabetes. And you have 17-year-olds with diseases of 70-year-olds. And a study just came out recently showing that young people with type 2 diabetes survival is worse than the kids with the old-time insulin-dependent juvenile diabetes, partly because they arrive with all these complicated diseases. Only thing we know that really works well for type 2 diabetes is the drugs work okay, tolbutamide, fenformin, and the rest, but
What really works is to walk. And so what's the big message? The only thing, what we've got to do is create environments that are irresistible in terms of people walking. It's not a lot of walking. 10,000 steps a day for 6 months, few days a week, they lose 5% of the body weight and their risk of becoming diabetic goes down, they're pre-diabetic. So we began to pull the data together on what are the benefits of well-built physical environments. This is the policy statement of the Academy of Pediatrics saying kids need to grow up in neighborhoods where they can walk. In the video series, we interview six girls in Smyrna, Georgia. They're 15 years old. They cannot go anywhere unless mom takes them, whether it's the mall or anywhere else. They're completely confined to their homes unless someone takes them in a car. For our elderly, Michael, you're a family practice doctor. You know when an older man loses his driving privileges, you worry about depression and even suicide. And you're asking, is there a gun in the house? And this kind of question, because it's really worrisome in our society because it's so isolating and disempowering in our society. An older person walks for a year about three times a week, their brain gets bigger by about 1.5%. If you're inactive, your brain gets smaller by about 1.5%. And brain size on an MRI in an older person actually correlates with brain functioning. This is really important for the architects in the room. I would not have predicted this. Here's a comparison of people 20 years ago and now. A wonderful study looking at, it's demographically balanced, the same ages and the same demography. 20 years apart, do you think people report excellent health more often or less over the course of the last 20 years in the similar demography? You got it. That's huge. When people say I'm in excellent health, that really, you pay attention. If they say I feel lousy, you pay attention. Can you go about your life? Or do you need help? You need help somebody getting you, you know, your meals upstairs? More than a 50% increase. This one shocked me. Do you need a wheelchair? Do you need a cane, a motorized wheelchair? We've gone from 3 to 7%. These people aren't that old. I mean, they're 60 years old. That's a huge increase. And a lot of this is going to be overweight and diabetes. You know that smoking went down. You know obesity went up. But this is the one that knocked my socks off. No regular physical activity. We docs have been wagging our finger at people for 30 years saying, be physically active, join the gym. And so the message I want to convey to those of you who help construct the world we're in is, if people want life, and live a long time, and liberty and freedom to go about, and happiness, we've got to create places that convey that, entice and encourage us. We have to have incidental physical activity in our lives. We shouldn't have to get in a car to buy a carton of milk or a newspaper. We ought to be able to meet a lot of our life needs. And people say, I don't like density. Well, we build a lot of crappy density in the United States. If you build good density with good sight lines, good vegetation, good sound insulation, good vent, other kinds of ventilation, people like living there if it's got cultural outcomes. So I got in trouble because I didn't have enough data. Here's what happened in the last 10 years worth of data. 58 articles before 2003, over 650 articles. So as you think about what you want to do in terms of the juncture between public health and RISD, probably some kind of joint degree program might not be a bad idea. There's both grant money coming down and there's actually jobs out there because some of the best and brightest people are doing the overlap of the two worlds. New York, Mayor Bloomberg, I gave a talk like this at AIA New York a few years ago, and I'm not saying I did it, but New York has really embraced smart design. It started with sustainability, but sustainability now, everybody gets sustainability, that's sort of common sense, and it's evolved into healthiness. And this is Cooper Union. I love the fact that sustainable lighting and daylighting of the hallway, but it's also encouraging people to take the stairs. Institute of Medicine, top 1,000 docs in the country, was asked, what do you think we should do about this terrible obesity epidemic? They gave 15 recommendations, and the first recommendation was not corn sugar and taxes. It was create environments that make it entice people to be physically active. Because even when you're overweight, you can overcome a lot of those effects by being active. But if you're both inactive and overweight, you're really asking for it. you smart people, you young people are really smart, because you don't want to be driving, paying $8,000 to $10,000 a year for a car and living in your cars and having the rat race lives that your parents had. And more than half of you are actually looking for homes in places that have density and meet their life needs without getting in a car. I put this one especially for RISD, and if you get a chance to look at the art trail in cultural trail in Indianapolis. I mean, Indianapolis would not be a place to be on my high list of places to visit. It turns out that with the artwork that originally philanthropic grants for artwork, and they put it along the trail, next thing you know, shops appeared and bike shops and all the rest. And now anybody that goes to a convention, if the weather's half decent, Indianapolis goes for a bike ride and sees the art trail and really is pursuing it. And by the way, it was a conservative Republican mayor. I'll stop in about a minute. So I'm a new grandpop, and I went to visit my son in Atlanta, and I hated living in Atlanta. I was so glad to leave there after 10 years. And my son actually lives downtown and really enjoys it, but the thing that's changed is the Beltline. And it'll eventually be about 30 miles, connecting parks, transit, people could bike to work and the rest. And we're out for a walk with the two-year-old and talking, and all of a sudden we stop, and I'm looking at an old buildings from basically the Civil War, I want to take a picture, and a young woman's running by, and she goes, "You want me to take your picture?" "Oh, yeah." So we have a picture of me and grandson. He said, "How do you like the trail?" "I love it. I love it." She starts to turn around and run, and she stops. There's a piece of paper on the ground. She goes over, picks it up, and puts it in the garbage. And I said to Ryan Gravel, who was the fellow that developed it, I said, "What was the most politically important? What was the most important thing about the Beltline in Atlanta?" And he said, "People love it. The politicians don't dare mess with it because people love it." And really, in the first chapter of my book, is what does love have to do with the built environment? People love the ciclovia, and I apologize. I don't know if Providence closes down for a bicycle event in Long Boulevard. You do it now, great. And it's been transformational in Los Angeles because we have wonderful weather and people didn't know it was a wonderful place to bike until they put ciclovia in place. The mayor, mayors are really important. I've given up on United States government at this point, but mayors are really important. I'll talk about master plans in the Q&A if you want to. I'll talk about health impact assessment if you want to, because I actually think the era of environmental impact assessment is inadequate, and we need to move to a much broader kind of set of assessments. Every change has a set of negatives. We need to figure out how we maximize the positives. Remember those guys that almost got me fired, the home developers? They have decided the biggest thing in business now is to create communities that are healthy, and so this is the Urban Land Institute. I gave a talk there about 2 years ago. There were 500 gold cufflinks in the room, and it was an amazing experience. They've decided they're going to really embrace healthy places. And all this stuff is on the web, by the way, and I'll leave the PowerPoint for you, except for the stuff about my dad. Put people first. These are people who always put money first. Put people first. I know talk is cheap, but that's at least a shift in the consciousness that we're building about people. And my favorite is number 5. Make healthy choices easy. In this beautiful building, you have beautiful stairs, and it's a healthy choice. And, you know, 6% of all the energy and electrical energy in a building goes to the elevators. If you can reduce that by half, that's money in the pocket for 100 years. These are business people. What's the business case for communities? And one of the places that features is Villa Verde in the South Bronx, built on a Superfund site. And people say, "Dick, you're encouraging gentrification." And maybe in a slight way I am, because if you move into a marginal neighborhood, you're going to hopefully fix up the front of your house. You're going to demand that the garbage picked up. You're going to demand that there's better policing. You're going to yell if the schools aren't adequate, and you're going to want a decent park. And I don't view that as gentrification. I view that as citizenship. Gentrification is where some developer makes a whole lot of money exploiting a whole set of loopholes, if you will, and then walks away with it. So let me stop there, and I hope I didn't go over time too much. Anyway, thank you so much.
Okay.
see. We're transitioning. Richard Jackson Dick, thank you so much for that keynote address that so, I think, generously and expansively touched on the interests and expertise of our audience represented here today. So thank you for being here and getting us started. It's my pleasure to introduce my Rhode Island School of Design colleague, Charlie Cannon, who will be moderating the panel that is about to begin. Charlie has taught in landscape architecture and architecture and graduate studies, but he was actually appointed full-time to the Department of Industrial Design in 2009, where he teaches studios on sustainable design and social innovation. Also, 14 years ago, he was one of the key founders of the Innovation Studio, which has pursued projects and research clusters around some very challenging, sometimes intractable issues about sustainable agriculture, how design can be used as an agent for rural economic development, and it has also explored how economic development can be used as a tool for ecological regeneration. He also is the co-principal investigator for Rhode Island's National Science Foundation EPSCoR grant, which is the experimental program to stimulate competitive research. It's a 5-year, $20 million grant. Both RISD and Brown and other academic institutions are part of that major project. I think it was either my first or second year when I was at RISD. There was a really remarkable conference, a 2-day conference that was funded by the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, one of their pioneer grants. It was organized largely by my colleague Brian Goldberg, who's sitting over there, as well as a committee at RISD that was called, I think, the Health and Wellness Working Group. It was actually part of our strategic planning process at RISD. And I don't think I really even knew you very well, Charlie, but I was so engaged and moved by your participation in that conference, as well as your role in leading a panel and really stimulating and helping to shape and guide a very, very vibrant conversation about very similar kinds of topics. So you're not really back here for an encore, but you're here to continue what we all understand is really one of the most significant and vital conversations of our day. Thank you.
So I'm going to invite the panel to come up, and I'm double mic'd, so if I start going woo, 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 make your way to the doors. And I will introduce the panel as we move forward, but I want to reach out to all of you who are sitting so far away, all the way in the back row, in the middle rows. We'd like to engage you in a kind of a free-form conversation. To do that, I'm going to sort of do some soft pitch questions to the panel and try to link some of the work that's happening right now in Providence with some of the insights and the findings that Dr. Jackson articulated. I think we are at a moment in the city, knock wood, in which I think there's an extraordinary amount of energy and excitement about thinking about the relationship between urban design, between the creative arts, and between public health. Between the ways that we think about how we program the city, how we use its parks, how we use its open spaces, how we think about how we redevelop and rebuild or regenerate the city, and how we take advantage of the stuff that's here already. How we're repurposing and rethinking about parking lots, about walkways, if we follow in some ways the Cyclovia and the work of Janet Sadek Khan in New York, these really inexpensive ways where we can leverage the infrastructure that we already have to create more walkable, more rideable, more human-centered, and as my friend Jan Gell from Copenhagen says, more design cities for people. Not for cars, not for houses, not for trucks, for people. And because we're at this incredible kind of moment in the city, we have this really deep panel, which I'm going to refer to and ask them to kind of draw some of those correlations, because we have people who are working, whether like Dr. Fine in the Department of Public Health, who are rethinking the way that we might distribute health and wellness services across our neighborhoods. We have people like Manuel, who is working through in the nonprofit sector and engaging citizens, engaging kids to redesign their community gardens, redesign their schools. We have people like Peter, who is actually helping to make sure that health is coming into the policy work in every way, through every possible lens in the city, through the city's, I'm going to forget because I'm far away from my notes, Healthy
Communities Office.
We have people like Nadine Gerdts, who is as a designer and a landscape architect, but also, frankly, as an activist, who are working here and in Boston, working to redevelop playgrounds, rethink the kinds of the programming, rethink what kind of educational and outdoor opportunities playgrounds represent in schools in neighborhoods that are challenged and neighborhoods that are not. And we have Akilah, who has been doing important research at Brown about figuring out and unpacking what are the kinds of impacts that HOPE6 multi-use and multi kind of, let's say, wider settlement patterns that are governmentally sponsored settlement patterns, that are mixed income developments and mixed income settlements, if you will, what impacts they're having on the public health, not only of the people who live in those HOPE6 developments, but also in their neighborhoods. And I think that in some ways, if we are at this moment, ideally at Providence, and if we're at this moment, hopefully at the country level, we're at a moment where I think that architects, designers, and creative artists are finally ready and maybe beginning to be able to take up the mantle of what I heard Dick charge me with, 10 years ago at an AIA conference, to be a frontline health officer as an architect. And I think we're at a moment where we're able to leverage the powerful research that's being done to actually leverage the kind of research that Akilah's doing and her insights as design insights. Right, so that we can begin to apply what is incredibly rigorous, evidence-based findings as inspirations to rethink the way that we're thinking about cities. So we have this moment where everybody at this table can be a designer, everybody at this table can be a healthcare officer, and I think that's really exciting. And I'm hoping that, I'm hoping that you'll join us in some of that conversation. So I'm going to step back over here to my notes because I've just been doing it off the cuff for a bit. I think that perhaps what Dr. Jackson is suggesting requires a way for us to think more concretely about the relationships between different sectors, different organizations, and different institutions that make up our communities. And so in some ways, I'm going to ask the panel to speak from their perspective, from the work that they're doing, and to link their insights in their own work to some of the larger themes of the presentation, but to do it in a way in which they're reflecting with us about their insights from their institutional or organizational or sector perspective. Right? Because these kinds of collaborations, the work that is being done or that needs to be done to rebuild our cities, can't happen. I'm a reformed architect, let me tell you, we can't do it by ourselves. I know that the translation of policy and public health insights into the built environment can't be done without architects and landscape architects. And I know that these collaborations, in order to begin to have real powerful substantive impacts, they need to be deeply collaborative, they need to be cross-institutional, they need to be cross-sector, and they need to be interdisciplinary. So I'm going to get off my high horse, because my job, as Patty said, is really to facilitate here, not so much to bring this particular perspective, or at least the variety of ways that I could imagine and be excited about doing this work with everybody here. So we'll start concretely. And to do that, we're going to go way down to the end. And I'm going to ask Peter, who is the director of the Providence Healthy Communities Office, as he so adroitly picked up when I dropped the ball, and an office which is promoting and improving health through environmental public health in Providence, and focused on that, through rethinking environmental systems, policies, and programmatic change, to reflect a little bit on the role that city government can play in creating these healthy cities, and creating cities for people.
Okay, thank you. I think that people that have studied or paid attention to the conversation about government in Rhode Island know the state as a whole, maybe geographically, but certainly with people, is far fewer, smaller than Los Angeles, just the entire state. We have 39 different local governments, and in some communities there are even multiple different little fire district governments and things like that. There's a lot of conversation about maybe we shouldn't have all these different local governments. But on the other hand, I think in terms of the way things are structured now, working in the biggest local government, what are all the things that it does that, you know, we don't have, local government doesn't have a direct official responsibility for public health in the way that it does in some other states. We have one health department that has that kind of responsibility for the entire state. At the same time, what are the things that the local government does do in Providence? It's maintaining the roads and the streets, operating the schools, picking up the trash, picking up the recycling, and now we're starting to, not picking up the compost yet, but we're getting to help people pick up their own compost in their neighborhood. Providing public spaces for people, parks, recreation centers, other green space, and having kind of responsibility for maintaining that. To some extent, regulating local commerce and regulating the way that local development happens. And of course, protecting public safety in terms of police and fire services and rescue services. Those are, that was just the list I kind of could think up while I was sitting here, and that's most of the things people think about. But that's a lot in terms of places where the health of the public can be impacted positively or negatively, I think. And it's not necessary, I'm not necessarily, in terms of talking about all the little governments, it's not necessarily the case that I think that it couldn't happen more effectively or better on some larger scale or consolidated scale. But at the same time, I know if you go to different parts of just the city of Providence, you see very different worlds. And I think having this, a city government try to be responsive to concerns people have in their different neighborhoods, even in the 18 square miles that is the city, is a challenge. I think that what I've been trying to do in helping Mayor Taveras with starting this office a little over 2 years ago is, as Charlie kind of said, thinking about all the different ways and all the things that the city does that have perhaps negative impacts on health that we could reduce in some way, or what are the opportunities to have positive impacts around people's health, and also that piece about trying to be responsive to what's happening in different neighborhoods. So, and sometimes it's, you know, there's conditions and things happening in the city that may not necessarily be, they may look like a failure of government. It may or may not be that. It's just difficult conditions and challenges people face. The fact that in certain neighborhoods in Providence, you see a lot of mattresses dumped in vacant lots and things like that. You don't see mattresses dumped in vacant lots where Dr. Fine lives in Scituate, at least I don't think very many. But that's not because somehow Scituate governments figured out how to deal with dumping of mattresses better than Providence. It's because there's something happening in the city where people dump mattresses. So, but even within the city itself, I think, so we're stuck, the city is stuck with all these kind of problems that are not necessarily its fault, but we have to figure out how to deal with those because those do have an impact on people's health and well-being.
So I think, I mean, part of what I would want to pull out from what you're saying and want to recap for as I think about who to call on next, because I think we're going to go off script, just so that you're all at the warning, right, is that there is, of course, the necessity of the creation and the maintenance of infrastructure, right, the built environment. When we think about creating cities, we think about the roads, we think about the sidewalks, we think about the streets. There are those services, right, that the city is delivering, which if we look at, you know, the history of urban design, one could read it as the history of public health, right? When we start to think about what is the right zoning for different kinds of uses, what should we pick up the garbage instead of just dumping it out of our second floor windows into the streets? How do we think about where, you know, what our access to open space should be like? And then a kind of a variety of programs that are over there, over and above the programming that is sort of sponsored by various city offices, right? So I can imagine, you know, the redevelopment of Burnside Park, for example, as a way of getting more people, creating a green space in the downtown that more people might want to spend time in, for example. I think for me that then the what you alluded to, perhaps, are questions of both environmental and economic justice and how those things actually tie quite closely to some of our public health, our larger public health concerns as we think about larger communities, right? As we think about the populations in cities, not the populations of an individual neighborhood or of a kind of a suburban situation. Given that, and given your, actually, I think I would like to, if Manuel would be interested in talking about, be willing to talk about the work that DownCity Design is doing as a nonprofit that is using design build, so engaging students from across the city to rethink whether it's their schools, the furniture of their classrooms, or their urban, their parks. To if you could kind of reflect on, I mean, it seems to me that there's something quite powerful in relationship to the city, right? How we reappropriate the city, and what are some of the impacts of the experiences of the students and perhaps their families in doing that?
Sure, thank you. I'm gonna answer your question in a second, but I do want to respond to Peter a little bit, because I think one of the interesting things to keep in mind is, as you know, in just listening to this great presentation just now, thinking about the kind of the changes necessary in the kind of hard infrastructure, and part of the interesting thing about what's happening in Providence right now is that some of the kind of soft infrastructure, the kind of government, is responding in a way that I think is necessary to create the changes in the hard infrastructure. So the creation of both Peter's office, but also an office of sustainability. And interestingly, when the policy director for Providence left, who stepped into that position but the sustainability director, which is actually happenstance, but kind of really amazing, because that meant that for however long that was happening, for a year maybe now, our chief of policy at Providence has been our sustainability director. That's awesome. So I just wanted to respond to that. And then I think, you know, to what you were saying, I think that so DownCity was born a little bit of the gap between my frustration of being an architect, and I think, like, you know, probably everybody sitting here and identifying with what Charlie said previously, being an idealist, you know, coming into the profession as somebody who wanted to kind of affect change in a kind of deep and meaningful way. And the other side, the kind of how limiting it can be sometimes in practice. And so there's a little bit of a correlation between that at a lot of different levels, at the government level and at a personal level, that gap between what you want to be doing and what can be done within the existing kind of structures and infrastructures that we have. And so DownCity was kind of born of that frustration of saying, we see projects that don't have traditional clients. We see projects that don't have traditional architectural or design services available to them. What can we create to fit that gap and try to connect those two extremes? And you know, the interesting thing about it is that as we start to do it, we see the room for so many more people doing this kind of work. It's just, it's really amazing and exciting. I mean, it is an exciting time.
So I'm going to go back to the question now.
Yeah.
So I rightly sidestepped it. So I'm curious about, and you know, I'm no scientist, right? I'm no doctor. I'm a former architect, for God's sake.
A politician.
But I play one on TV. So I'm not looking for quantitative data, but I'm curious about the. It seemed to me, right, as I think about the work that DownCity is doing, or the work that Nadine is doing through the Inside Out Studio at RISD, that there's a very powerful, or there's an opportunity for powerful engagement and for a sense of empowerment, right? That actually feels to me that it is related to and moves us and moves people towards not only thinking about how they can engage in their environment or engage in their community, but also I would think, you know, contributes actually to their health. But I'm curious about what you found in terms of those You know, how do students respond? What's happening?
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, it's amazing. It's so fun to work with students and to see them gain that sense of agency. You know, we recently cut a ribbon on a rainwater harvesting system at a local garden, the Peace and Plenty Garden, and it was built by middle schoolers. It's a little bit insane. I actually see some folks who worked on it as well. When we cut the ribbon, we have several students there, and to hear them talk about the project and in particular to talk about kind of having come to understand what has to happen to make something like that happen and what they had to do and the challenges that they faced. And one student in particular just stood under the structure, and I loved it. He just basically said, "Guys, there's nothing here before. There's nothing. There's nothing here before." He said it several times. He wanted us to know that he had been part of a big change to that lot. And it's amazing to see that and to see the kind of, you know, the effect of that in that community garden and how the community has kind of come to love it as a part of their kind of daily life, especially in the summer.
Right, and it's probably not for nothing, right, that example is both community garden, rainwater harvesting, so it's, you know, contributing to the resilience of that part of the community. And but I think that sense of ownership is so important. And actually, I want to use that, Akilah, if I may, as a kind of segue. So we have this sort of deep panel, this deep bench, and we're moving back and forth in some ways between different kinds of scales and different actors. And Akilah Dulin-Keita's research as assistant professor here of behavioral and social sciences at Brown has been looking at how HOPE-6 mixed-use developments, what impacts they have on public health in their communities. And I think it's relevant, and obviously a kind of a jump up in scale for a moment, but I'd be curious if you could share more about that and more about your findings and how you think they're relevant to this conversation.
Sure. So let me just provide a bit of background information on HOPE-6, which stands for Housing Opportunities for People Everywhere. My work really focuses on socioeconomically distressed and disadvantaged communities, and HOPE-6 attempts to revitalize these communities by creating mixed-income housing developments to reduce the concentration of poverty. So the community that I actually worked in also installed walking trails, bike paths, installed more lighting, and also reduced the shrubbery. And what we did is really work with the community first to see how they perceived HOPE-6 would influence their community health and well-being. And what we found is that doing some quantitative follow-up and through discussions with community members, that HOPE-6 actually increased perceptions of safety in the community. It reduced the fear of victimization for community members. It increased the odds of neighborhood-based physical activity and attenuated the gender differences, once accounting for reduced perceptions of fear of victimization. So not only creating a built environment that can transform communities, but also creating change that can facilitate social change within communities is also important. So not merely building it will they come, but making sure that the social environment is supportive for physical activity in those particular communities. And I know you had also asked me another question about what public health can add, and so I want to just mention a few highlights. I think that first, public health can, we take the approach of doing community engaged research, so including all key stakeholders in all decision making, because at the end of the day, community residents are going to be affected by our policies. We get to leave, but they have to stay. And so making sure that they have a voice, so bringing all key stakeholders to the table is extremely important. Another component in which we could be instrumental is developing clearly stated objectives related to health and providing evidence from the public health-based literature to inform design. We can also talk about insights into how both built and social environments interact to facilitate or create health behavior changes. We provide rigorous evaluation to determine program effects. We can make sure that the programs are sustainable, because everything is new at one point. But if it's not sustained, if it's not maintained, it'll go into disrepair and you'll end up with the same thing you had to start out with. And lastly, I think that one of many other things, but public health practitioners can pair interventions with urban design to promote health.
Could you say more about that? That last one about pairing those interventions with
sure. design. So literature clearly states, and as Dr. Jackson mentioned, that healthy food access is an issue in low-income communities. But merely creating healthy food options or putting in supermarkets doesn't mean that people are going to use them. And research has borne that out through many of the initiatives that we have tried to implement in low-income communities. So pairing it with an intervention like Dr. Kim Gant has, for example, which is the Fresh to You, which pairs not only healthy fruit and vegetable access, but with nutrition education, recipes, and bringing in community partners along the whole process.
Thank you. I mean, it seems to me, and Nadine, I'm looking right at you, right? So it seems to me that there's a way that if Akilah has answered what public health can do, maybe it's time to ask what design can do. Mm-hmm. And so I'm going to look at Nadine Gerdts, who was introduced earlier as a senior critic in the landscape architecture program here at RISD. Or over there at RISD, and who's been working for years now with students at RISD and at public schools to use design to construct new partnerships between RISD as a design school with these public schools and the programming and educational opportunities in those schools to create new conditions in their playgrounds, which is a really terrible way to describe it. Does, right? So she'll do a better job of that. But if we could kind of go back and talk about your sense of the design's contribution in these multi-stakeholder projects, I think that would be helpful.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I think it is interesting that this whole conversation is we're jumping back and forth through different scales, and the scale of housing is a really important issue. And the work that I'm going to talk about is at the scale of the schoolyard. And a lot of the work is similar to Manuel's work with DownCity Design, but I think what we've been able to do with the Inside Out Studio and working with the Boston Schoolyard Initiative in Boston, the school that I've worked primarily with is the Rafael Hernandez School, which is a bilingual school in Roxbury. And what we've been able to do is work with students, young students, and with RISD students around this question, around making, really. And the main goal of the work is that kids actually do stuff. That they go out, they plant bulbs, they help plant trees, they can take ownership in their schoolyard. And by doing that, it builds their sense of civic responsibility. And it really gets back to that question of love that Dr. Jackson brought up, that it's really that they own a place. And it may be that they just paint something a color that they like, or that they get to transform a space temporarily, or they get to speculate about what a bulb is when it goes in the ground, and they get to see that in the spring. But making that real connection makes all the difference. And it really is this equation of health and environment that I think is so important.
So as we've been listening to everybody, I've been watching Dr. Fine scribble away. And
it's a medical disorder.
Which may be a chemical disorder. He may need the ink. And lean into the microphone periodically. And so I'm going to let him talk about whatever he wants to talk about. So Mike Fine is the director of the Department of Public Health. And in that role, is launching a really important initiative called the Neighborhood Health Station, which I'll let him talk more about. And which I know is based on, you know, his own experience as a health practitioner here in Rhode Island, helping to set up, you know, Hillside?
Mm-hmm.
A medical practice that allowed people from all over the Hillside neighborhood in, at the end of Pawtucket and the top end of Providence to kind of come in and use the facilities, get help as they needed it, and figure out the appropriate ways for them to engage and pay for that health care. It's remarkable to me to see an opportunity that's being sponsored by the state for a model like this that is talking about wellness, not just illness, but health and wellness, to be possibly then being seen as an initiative that we could see across the state. But I'm sure you have plenty of other things to talk about, so you just talk about whatever you want. So.
Totally, thanks. So first, I'm a truth be told, some of you know this, that I'm a community organizer masquerading as a family physician, masquerading as a public health person. And that, over the course
of... Halloween's not even over, apparently.
Yeah. And that, actually, over the course of my professional so-called career, has sort of helped me think about communities and health in a somewhat different way. So first, thanks to Dr. Jackson for helping people understand what health is. Because when you get right down to it, much of what we're struggling with is that really basic question. As people with something to sell are in a big hurry to define it as something that will let them sell stuff. So, you know, we've been able to design things incorrectly. In 1985, we designed the incentivization of the growth of corn and wheat and increased caloric availability from 3,200 calories to 3,700 calories, 3,900 calories per person per day. Most adults need 1,100 or 1,200, and we created obesity. In 1969, 90% of kids walked to school or rode a bike to school. Now it's less than 10%. We've designed things the way they look, and we've gotten the outcomes that one might have thought. The challenge is to understand the value and meaning of community in the human project and design a world around that human project, that community, so that health as we come to understand it really becomes the equal ability to function in relationships and to participate in democracy, because community and democracy are critical to our sense of who we are and our sense of meaning and value in our world. So that's a little ramble, forgive that. You know, it's worth just mentioning what we've been working on around neighborhood health stations. And then describing the fairly miraculous process that's happening in Central Falls as we speak. We kind of came up with this notion of neighborhood health stations because we could understand that the public health data that we have access to helps us understand that much of what we spend money on as a place and as a state and as a nation is wasted. We spend money on medical care, but at least 30% of that is wasted. That's $1 trillion a year. And that's painful enough, but that means we're not spending money on education and safe and healthy housing and on public transportation, the things that matter for longevity, as well as the things that matter for community. And so the challenge for us was to think out how we recreate the delivery system, the infrastructure, what you're interested in, and how we get out of that a delivery system that A, is affordable, and B, helps build community where it is. So we sort of looked at a bunch of very good evidence about what matters in medical services, and it turns out that there's reason for believing that if you put doctors and nurses and physical therapists and home health aides and emergency medical services in one team taking care of one community together, you can reduce the cost of healthcare 30 to 50% and improve life expectancy fairly substantially. And as you do that, leverage local spending. Each one of these, if you do it for 10,000 people, each one of these costs or spends somewhere between $6 and $18 million a year, but does it locally, you actually leverage it for local economic development, and it becomes the keystone for neighborhood development. You can do that, and as you do it, you create community in each place. So we started working on that after our community health assessment in Central Falls. Where what we heard was people wanted a place to exercise after school, and they wanted a place for their kids to be safe, and they wanted a place for adults to exercise, and they actually wanted access to primary care services. And so the role of the state health department became becoming a convener. We brought a bunch of people together from Central Falls. We brought folks in the school system, folks from Progressive Latino, folks from the city, folks from the community health center, and folks from the local hospital, and others. And we said, you know, what would it be like to build one of these, you know, neighborhood health stations and not only do medical services, but also build a gym and a pool and a climbing wall and a bicycle repair shop, really turn it into a community center. And an amazing thing happened, and it kind of gets at what Nadine was describing. We found all these people jumping in and making it happen together. So it wasn't so much about building a building. It became very quickly about building a community. And that has made amazing organic process, almost on its own. So that group of people came together, put together a school-based health center in the Central Falls High School, and as a sort of early victory, and now is working on building the whole thing. The building is important, but more important than the building is the community. And that's the challenge for all of us together. It's the built environment for sure, but it's getting to a kind of critical consciousness about what matters for communities and democracy in order to get people together to work on that built environment. It's the process of coming together that's transformational.
I think what, so as Dr. Jackson periodically would say, this slide is for the architects and the creatives and the artists. I think this is a very important reflection back that I want to give back to everybody who's not in the world of the built environment professionally, to say that I think one of the things that Michael is describing there is something that we often, even architects, even landscape architects, often forget, or sometimes we don't shade or talk about as we don't bring it front and center as much, right? Which is that our urban design work, that the design of the buildings, that the design of the landscapes, is ultimately in the service of some larger urban ambition, right? And that is what we are looking for is not the building, at least from my perspective, and at least from my perspective when I've worked as an urban designer, but what we're looking for is what can we deliver in this community? How can we use this as a stimulus or a catalyst in the community? And what's interesting to me, and what was exciting to me just about watching the way this panel was assembled, of which I had played no part, right, was to see the as each individual kind of has kind of, as I came to know their work, and as we've begun this conversation, is to see the ways in which each of our respective disciplines is talking about those fundamental questions, about community, about health, about democracy, about our ability to participate more fully, our ability to function more fully. Nadine's gonna make a point, and then I'm gonna ask the doctors a question about how much time we spend in the doctor's office, and then I wanna open it up to you guys. So, We've got plenty of time, and I want to make sure that you feel like you can, you know, go after any single member of this panel.
Yeah, I just wanted to make a point about it's just these collaborations that are so important that Dr. Fine was talking about, and that they take such a long time to develop. The Boston Schoolyards Initiative that I was talking about grew out of conversations that started with something called the Boston Green Space Alliance, which was started with a two-year conversation that was just assembling different constituencies so everyone could speak the same language. And I think that's what the point that you were making is that it's building that community so that then you can move forward and make changes.
It's like a freefer, right? So if I'm going to the doctor, if I'm an average American, how many hours do I spend in a doctor's office?
Waiting or being seen?
Right.
Total. In a year?
It's about 2.5 to 3 times per person per year. And my guess it's an average of a year, an hour or two each time. Sound about right?
Yeah. So maybe 6 hours total.
6 hours total.
If you're unhealthy.
If you're unhealthy. Some people more, some people less.
So that's 8,760 hours in the year. Whoa. Right, so 8,754 hours. We spend maybe 6 hours attending to illness, right? And which means that we have this other 8,754 hours of the year to attend to wellness and to attend to health, which we, health stations notwithstanding, that we don't do in under the surveillance of or in the offices of our doctors, right? But that's something that we have to do in the places that we live, in the communities, the neighborhoods, the offices, the schools, the housing that we live in.
Well, and you know, if health is about relationship, you know, most of that attending to is totally outside the so-called healthcare system, which some people have called the sick care system. And yet that's not where we put our emphasis or our spending.
All right, so let's change that. Questions? I'm sure some of you got some. Yes, sir.
Thank you again, Richard. That was wonderful. And your storytelling is really tremendous. And thank you again for coming. So I would like to know from the panel whether replacing the 19th century water system in Providence has annoyed you to the point where some of your suburban pals are almost ready not to come into Providence anymore. Because it would please me, since we know that automobiles and the presence of automobiles are sort of a marker of our environmental health, it would please me to see some empty parking lots around all the tax-exempt hospitals and government, state government installations in Providence, while Providence is being essentially ignored by our General Assembly in terms of allocating equitably state resources to address some of the less important issues that we've all just clarified in terms of our health. So having decent housing, having schools that are safe for our kids and supportive of families, having neighborhoods where there are people actually feeling safe to go to a park could be achieved at a lot higher rate if our General Assembly wasn't ignoring urban conditions. So I'll be interested in knowing, Mike, I know this is an issue that affects public health because when I came to Rhode Island, our state budget was twice in the old dollars what it is today. And we really would like to hear all of you address this wonderful feeling that we all have about what's possible and the reality of in Rhode Island, the structural violence against urban communities by our General Assembly. Mike, I know you're on the hot spot, so I apologize for setting it up, but that's my question.
Well, if I can address that question as directly as I can, not for nothing, but what is it, 40% of us vote? There is this...
Less. Unfortunately, less.
Right? So there is this de-agency of human beings. We have become consumers. And unless we change that and get people connected, both to communities and to the democratic process...
We've got to organize.
Well, that's,
Very good. One of the masks has come off, right? One of the masquerades has come off. I know that Dr. Jackson also wanted to address this question.
Several thoughts. I had this litany of things that are wrong. We got CO2 in the atmosphere at 400 parts per million instead of 300 parts per million. We're looking at climate change Rhode Island will do pretty well with a 5-foot sea level rise, but will not do very well at all over about 10. We're looking at the obesity epidemic, the crushing costs of healthcare, the deindustrialization of the United States, the need for people to have real work. The lower 80% of our population is earning exactly the same as they were in 1980 in real dollars. The top 20% have done quite well, and the top 1-2% have done extraordinarily well, particularly after taxes compared to everyone else. So we've got an economic system. We have got to think about fixes that go across the domains. So number one, and I have been doing a lot of work in Detroit where they're taking down buildings, and they need to take down buildings because they're dangerous and uninhabited. And so as they put people to work to both capture a lot of the embedded wealth that are in these buildings, just the lumber, the concrete, and the rest, they have to put in sewer systems all through because they have a common sewer outflow. So they get even the tiniest bit of rain, it all goes into the beautiful fresh water of the lakes, all the sewers and everything else. And they're going to have to do that. People say, well, where's the money? Well, there are some real tax sources. And so we have in California have now taxed utilities. And people say, oh, that's unpopular. We raised $1 billion this past year in carbon taxes under cap and trade. And 25% of that's gone to poor communities. And the poor communities might say, well, we want, and I'm going to say this respectfully, we want to pay our food bills. No, it's not going to go to food bills. It's going to go to infrastructure because it's got to be something that gives a long-term benefit. And by the way, educated and smart young people are, I believe, are kind of the infrastructure. We just passed the sugar tax. No one needs to eat that much fructose. You can have a teaspoon a day, but you're... and we need to be using that money, and the money needs to go to young people. And we need to stop spending so much money on everybody else because all of our real changes as a society have started with our young people. Doesn't matter whether it's seatbelts or recycling or you name it, we invest in young people because these are generational changes. It took a generation to get in the situation we're in now. There's a real optimism, and I want to say this to Peter. I was with the head of sustainability in Washington, D.C. yesterday, Brendan Shane, and the sustainability people are really at the crest of success, and they really need to begin to embrace the health issue as the new kind of sustainability. And the mayors like this. The mayors are really the people that are showing real leadership, and that's why the sugar tax, the carbon tax, safe routes to schools, open schoolyards, and the rest are things we need to do. Sidebar, but when we got the TARP funding in the San Francisco Bay Area, it was used to connect the bike routes, and it sounds kind of corny, but the bike routes before that went from nowhere to nowhere. And people say, hey, you know, and it was something somebody did on a Sunday afternoon, but it really wasn't being used to get to work, to get to school, to get to retail, and it completely has transformed bicycling in many of these places. And bicycling isn't going to cure everything, but exercise, less congestion, less pollution, it's a good thing. So I really want to convey a very strong message to the young people in this room that nothing will change if you don't have a vision. Nothing will change if you have 20 priorities. You got to pick the big one. It almost doesn't matter what the big priority is, but pick something that you want to. And I would focus on young people and their development as a way to go. Sorry, that long speech, but let me get one last quick thing. The Vietnam War was ended partly because it was expensive and partly because of culture. It was the rock and roll from 1967 to 1972 that completely changed young people's consciousness. And you who are artists are the agents of culture change. And you don't need 100% of the population to cause a shift. All you need is, and I'm not making this up, the data's there, about 7% of the population who are charismatic, who are energetic, who are leaders, to begin to pull, and the rest of the population will go along. So go away from this feeling like I need to be the change agent. Work with other people. It doesn't matter what you pick for number one, but just don't show up and ask for 20 things because you will get nothing.
So I'm going to, very shortly, I'm going to get the nod and the crook, so I'm going to turn to make sure that we ask some more questions. I think the other thing that I would want to add is that what is clear as we look across the country and indeed across the globe regardless of whether we're looking at Eastern or Western nations, or whether the global South or the global North, is that mayors, that the city is the level of the greatest action right now. You know, in the United States, we see this because we see gridlock at the federal government level. But if we look more broadly, we see that that bit about politics being local, that bit about being able to change the community that you're living in, actually acting locally, is working. And we see these in offices of sustainability, we see these in offices of public health, we see this, that's the integer right now. And if any, I mean, I take the structural problems, the larger structural problems, as being difficult, and to say the least, in Rhode Island. But the right now, cities seem to be the place to act, and the cities seem to be the places that are acting most effectively. So I'm gonna turn.
We need the tools to be able to act.
Agree.
We can't do it with being choked by a state legislature.
Agree. But we need to develop this in a number of ways.
Property taxes are not enough.
I couldn't agree with you more. I'm gonna turn here. Yes.
Okay. I have a bit of a complex question, but I just want you to bear with me. So basically, given Dr. Kia's findings on the Hope 6, and she talked about the increased perception of safety and victimization and kind of like social change and voice, what does a paired intervention look like with urban design? And then what suggestions can address the symptoms and impacts of specifically neighborhood disadvantage for racial and ethnic minorities that live within those communities? And then if you can like kind of touch on those, like how do you come in and build community where it is without participating in acts of gentrification when you are trying to focus on urban design?
I'm glad that's directed to you. That'll give the rest of us time to think.
I actually didn't know if that was directed to me. There were a couple things that
it was directed to
everyone.
As a segue in.
So I definitely think that's a great point. How do you create urban renewal without gentrification? And Hope 6 has been defunded, but one of the strategies was renewal but not gentrification, where the people who are the original place of the community get pushed out. So with different developments, mixed income housing could be rentals, mixing rental types, so providing subsidized rentals but also market rate rentals to attract more middle income individuals. And that has been one of the main routes to reduce disadvantage. So when she mentioned disadvantage, she's talking about the concentration of low-income individuals within a community, talking about levels of 40% and above of community members living below poverty. So with the community that I worked with, poverty level was actually 55% of people live below poverty level. You asked what a parent intervention would look like. So one of the things we can look to, again, and I want to keep mentioning the First to You intervention, but pairing, for example, a grocery store. So you're building a new grocery store, a supermarket, and you want people to use it. Well, pair it with an intervention and also gauge what people's perceptions are of their neighborhood. Our research and the work of others has shown that people who perceive their neighborhoods as disordered don't shop there. They just don't. So merely building a supermarket is not going to increase rates of usage, but changing neighborhood perceptions and also providing people ways to opportunities to eat healthy. We know that in neighborhoods that are disadvantaged, they have a higher density of fast food restaurants, for example, and more corner stores, more unhealthy foods. So does this create a cultural norm of unhealthy eating within that community? So not only addressing the built environment, but addressing the neighborhood level norms.
Which also sounds a little bit like some of the underlying rationale for the neighborhood health stations, right? In which, if I understand them correctly, right, which are connecting the healthcare expertise, opportunities to participate in other health building conditions, and doing it in the context of a local neighborhood, presumably under the aegis of the Office of the State Department of Public Health, which feels like that another kind of, maybe a prototype of some of those kinds of interventions.
It actually turns out that about 25% of all local economic activity is healthcare. And rather than let it be sort of pulled away and, you know, spending in Providence, ending up in Barrington and East Greenwich. The idea is to spend it locally and leverage that spending so that we're not just buying healthcare services, we're effectively buying community.
And I would also add, recognizing that norms and behavior change takes time. Yeah. So we implement policies and we want a quick change, but that's not going to happen. And being patient.
The poorest part of Los Angeles is Boyle Heights, and the trucks come out of the Port of LA, these huge trucks, diesels, and they drive through and they tuck down the stop signs, and it's terrible. That part has been really difficult. And there was an effort to have a ciclovia, a bicycle event in Boyle Heights, and a community meeting happened, and the community said, this is stupid. This is not what we're worried about. We're worried about our sidewalks and the rest. And the community was very clear sequentially about what they want, and the dialogue process was the most important thing. And the mayor started to show off and say, well, all right, we're going to have better policing. We're going to control the trucks coming off the 710 freeway going through here. And the point of doing the bicycle event was like the fourth thing they got to, but a whole bunch of positive things happened. And the community, the process of being organized to demand that was probably as valuable as each of the individual outcomes. But this takes time, and it just because you say it doesn't mean it's going to happen.
I have a quick follow-up. I'm sorry, but I have a quick follow-up question. I think it was more concerning kind of like the urban design and if the architecture that's on the panel can speak to like how, what kind of their vision or their suggestions for it too, because I think, you know, we place these two things in different binaries and they're just not really connecting very well for me. So if you could, you know, just speak on that.
Right, I think part of your earlier question was a question about gentrification and equity too. I mean, you know, are those issues that that come to the fore as a neighborhood changes? And I think those are really complex issues that cities are grappling with as you, you know, build transit lines that are, you know, are demanded by low-income communities. You often get an influx of more moderate or upper-income residents, and you start this process of gentrification. And so, how do you ensure that there is housing that remains for moderate and low-income residents in a community? The Fairmont corridor in Boston, this is an example where this is happening right now. The neighborhood over 10 years advocated to get lower transit fares, so the commuter rail stops only cost people $2 to get into town to jobs rather than $7, which it had cost for a very long time. It's happening. There's rail. There's new rail stops. There are safe transit stops in a neighborhood of triple deckers that has been a long time moderate and low income neighborhood, and the gentrification is happening. And so it's very complicated, and it requires a lot of community groups to just, you know, push for affordable housing, and it requires a mayor that cares about that kind of thing, and an economic office that cares.
And I mean, I just to that question of complexity, I mean, I would say whenever I've been a part of a lot of community planning processes in which it's just so helpful to just unpack that word and just talk about so many factors that either, you know, you as a person are bringing in or the community is bringing in. You know, it's everything from, and you know, it's the same with that word, the diversity word. I mean, we deal with it a lot in my community on the West Side in Providence, and this question of diversity. Well, what does diversity mean, and what kind of diversity? You know, there's the socioeconomic, there's the age. I mean, that's a really interesting one for us, the kind of age diversity in our neighborhood. You know, especially in the context of what we do with our old people now, like, right, we ship them off, right? And so recently we had one of our few homes in the neighborhood was about to close. It's right on the park. It's a wonderful partner to the neighborhood, a great neighbor. And nobody even realized that this was happening. But this just goes to that question of, you know, there's so many ways to talk about diversity. I might not look like it. I'm a Puerto Rican born and raised, and I when I moved into the neighborhood, was viewed as a gentrifying force because of what I look like. And so, you know, and by kind of white Anglo-Saxon male of all people. You know, so I always am very careful about how we kind of frame conversations around understanding how we come together as a community.
I think that the other side, another side of that coin around gentrification is a kind of pessimism that fully poor neighborhoods are never going to have some of these things, and as soon as you can't kind of put some nice things in a low-income neighborhood, or else it's the equilibrium's going to be gone, and it's not going to be a neighborhood for that group of people anymore. I think that one thing to say in terms of like in Providence, I'm thinking about it, we just need to focus on the places that are the furthest, that have the greatest challenges in some ways, that gentrification is so far from being, you know, so for example, like the tree canopy in the city ranges by neighborhood from 40% in the, you know, leafiest places that are close to here to 6%. So that's a pretty big differential. And if you go, I don't know if anyone has heard of not the official name, but area that's called Clown Town. It's only about a mile and a half from here, Upper South Providence area. There's a lot of streets that are residential streets, and there's no sidewalk at all. So we're looking at like a city plan around pedestrian friendliness, bike friendliness and stuff. And there's places where there's a bunch of homes all right next to each other, and there's no sidewalk there. And there's the vacant lots that have and Manny was talking about before, people would have said there was nothing here, there's nothing here, there was nothing here before, or there's a lot of junk dumped there and all those kind of things. So there's so much that can be done. I like the Peace and Plenty Park project that is in a relatively low-income neighborhood, and that's something that can give people some pride about their neighborhood, feel positively about it. And we also, this past summer, we were working with the Partnership for Providence Parks, which is a coalition of neighborhood friends, groups for city parks. And at 5 city parks in kind of different low-income areas in the city, we had play workers there during the summer meal program for 3 hours a day, people that were there, adults and young adults there to help foster creative play by kids in these parks. And those were, in some cases, parks people, parents, and kids might have not thought they were safe. And but now there's all these kids that are playing there and doing stuff, and that in itself changes the perception. So there are policy things that you should try to do to make sure that neighborhoods don't become out of reach for people that are living there. It's definitely something that has to be done. But I also think that we have to talk about the fact that everyone deserves to have green space in their neighborhoods. Everyone deserves to have a park where they can go play and all those kind of things. Everyone deserves to be able to have sidewalks at a very basic level when they live in a residential urban neighborhood. So, I think that's, there is a balance there, yes.
So I know there are hands there, 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 and there, and I'm looking over here and want to be mindful of the fact that I am 4 minutes past my bedtime, I think, or at least 8 more minutes. Okay, so I'm gonna point over to the woman with glasses who's holding a pen at me, and then maybe we can come back over here if we still have time at the end. And, well, I know that's Anne, who teaches architecture at the time. And before you go, I think the other thing I would like to make sure is that there'll be a reception afterwards, and so it will, I know that the conversation can continue in a less formal, less mediated way, and I'm sure you'll all be glad to get rid of me as a membrane between you and the panel. So feel free to come up with them afterwards if you haven't gotten, we haven't been able to get you in.
Thank you. I think that Nadine's comment that about gentrification, if lowering train fares is leading to gentrification, we're in a really bad conundrum, right? So that as soon as we put advantages in a place, they are taken advantage of, and that disadvantages our disadvantaged communities. So we need some tools which are not simply in the development toolbox right now, like going back to rent control or whatever it is, that we can keep people in places as we improve them. But the point I wanted to make is that we were asked about design, and it's important for the non-designers to think about the fact that design is a tool and a process and not a style, and it's increasingly one that is being used to engage communities. So I think there are these two issues represented in the panel, and one of them is that we want to work in communities and not on them, that there's a lot of discussion about stakeholder engagement and community engagement and working with communities. At the same time, government is represented and has a different role. And I would say to Peter Asen that I hope that in the city of Providence, the Healthy Communities Office is also working. You talked about the functions of government, which really in this case, which are partly maintenance and management as being incredibly important, but also policies and permitting. And the permitting role, I think, has not been talked about very much. But the idea that all of this insight about what makes healthy communities is, I think, lagging in our permitting standards at this point. And that was, Dr. Jackson also referred to that in the sense that we have now, we put a lot of pressure and a lot of community weight on our EIRs and our environmental impact programs, but putting health metrics into those kinds of permitting processes at the federal level and then at the city level as well, that we build that into when people are first designing and bringing projects forward for permitting.
And we are, the city is just about completing a process of redoing its zoning ordinance that really for the first time, the ordinance that was being revised was written in 1951, and it's the first major change in 20 years. And the first purpose, I just went and looked at the new draft that's about to be approved, and the first purpose that's listed among a list of like 10 purposes is protecting that public health, safety, and general welfare. And that's supposed to be one of the number one purpose of zoning. So and there are a lot of positive things that are happening there in that ordinance with transit-oriented development, denser development, and on corridors and things like that. But also, it is true that even there, this is a great positive change, I think, but there's still a gap sometimes between, or almost all the time between developing a policy and then how it's implemented. And there's like a long-term, there needs to be a lot of long-term focus put on actually implementing things successfully. I just think about like this past week that New York City implemented a 25 mile an hour speed limit, which was 30 previously, but, and partly they're trying to like limit there's somewhere in Scandinavia where they were trying to get zero pedestrian deaths a year, and this was kind of like what the mayor there is trying to do. And my wife grew up near Queens Boulevard, which is like a notorious place for dying as a pedestrian. And it's too bad that the video Dr. Jackson wasn't able to show, because if you go and watch it, there's a great part about him kind of running across one of those like Atlanta 8-lane freeways as the cars are driving by. But I was thinking about the thing with New York is the speed limit most in New York City is 30 miles an hour, but if you've driven around in New York or driven in a cab or in a car with somebody in New York, you know that that 30 mile an hour speed limit was not necessarily being heeded. Yeah, so now maybe if it goes 25, everyone will be 5 miles an hour less fast, but maybe not. There's a question of enforcement and how do you get people to take it seriously. So,
Can I just jump? Yeah, go ahead.
I've probably read 100 environmental impact assessments, which is too many. 997 pages are about things that don't interest me terribly. They get to the health thing and they say, no air standards, no water standards will be violated. It's okay. They spend more time talking about Indian relics, I say that respectfully, than they do about what happens to children, old people, and everybody in between. A lot of us in the health world feel very strongly that we need to do a health impact assessment. Every intervention we put in place, doesn't matter whether it's medicine or anything else, has negatives. And as we make our life decisions, you want to maximize the positives, minimize the negatives, and you want to have an explicit discussion of every one of them. And that's what we ought to be doing as we're making our decisions about the world we build. Very quickly, there is now a pediatrician friend of mine who is in Jerry Brown's office, and they are rewriting the Constitution for Growth for the state of California, and there is a standalone health element. Her name's Elizabeth Baca, a Latina who's trained at Kennedy School of Government, among other things, and it will stand on its own with the same power as all the other things in the Constitution for Growth, and health will be traced all the way through it. And that's a kind of document that really should be available to everyone. Very quickly, my son, as I said, lives in Atlanta, and Snowmageddon was a colossal event. They had 2 inches of snow, and the city was stopped for 36 hours, and people were shivering in their cars. The main reason for that was too many stupid little governments. And they were all isolated. There really wasn't a coordinated response. And too little governance is, or governance is bad, but too much government with everybody with a finger in their pie and a lot of, as my wife used to call it, cracker potentates dictating what's going to happen meant that things weren't working very well. So I do think thinking about governance in a very coherent way is important.
So I'd like to thank you all for being with us today and helping us to launch what we hope is an important initiative to look at design and population health. And if you are, any of you are interested in being an agent of change in this regard, we'd like to welcome you to join us tomorrow to continue this conversation in a workshop that will occur at the Graham Visual and Materials Center, which is the second floor, room 204, of the Fleet Library at 15 Westminster Street. We will begin at 8:30 and go until 11, so we do welcome those of you who would like to be here, there to join us on the RISD campus. And now I would like to invite all of you to join us for a reception. It's in Studio 1. Which is, if you are taking the elevator, I know we're not supposed to, but if you're taking the elevator, it's at 4S, or you can take the stairways up and follow the crowd to wine and beer and cheese and goodies. So thank you all for coming.